Hello from the Hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. I'm Sarah Smith, Senior Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I want to thank all of you for joining us for today's webinar, Applying Anti-Racist Principles in Your Leadership, presented by GUAA Career Coaching Partner Natalie Radolinski, undergraduate class of 1998, and Hoya friends Kim Dabru and Dr. Gloria González. Before we get started, I'd like to share a few webinar tips and reminders. First, this webinar is being recorded and it will be made available to all registrants on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel within 48 hours of today's broadcast. You'll receive the link to the webinar recording in a webinar follow-up email, which will also contain a post-webinar survey for you to take, information on upcoming webinars, and more ways to stay connected with Georgetown Alumni Career Services. Our presenters have a couple of questions for you today throughout their presentation. When you see those questions launched out to you or asked, please do take just a few seconds to reply. We look forward to hearing your responses. And our presenters will conduct a Q&A session at the end of their webinar, and they look forward to hearing your questions. So please send in your questions and comments as you have them throughout the webinar using the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. Finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area of the GoToWebinar system as well. For reference, Natalie, Kim, and Gloria's full bios can be found on our Alumni Online calendar and in the GoToWebinar registration page for this session. At this time, I'm pleased to turn things over to our presenters so that they can introduce themselves further and get our webinar underway.
Wonderful. Thank you, Sarah. We're excited to be here with you today to share our perspectives for how you can apply anti-racist principles in your leadership. Firstly, when we say leader, we're not talking about rank. We mean embracing leadership in whatever seat you might sit in, at work, at home, in social circles, in your community, in schools. We recognize we're stepping into a complex topic with not a lot of time, and so we see this conversation as a beginning for the work of how to show up differently. To that end, we ask that you have a piece of paper or a notebook handy. There are a few places in the presentation where we'll be asking you to reflect. We'll also have some time for questions at the end, as Sarah mentioned. If you have questions that come up for you as we go, you can put them into the question box and we'll get to as many as we can. Our invitation for the next hour is to be present with this work. What does that mean? Do this one thing for the next hour and let yourself be here. As you slow down, consider who you are and where you are in this moment, whatever may be going on. We often look to wise voices to help us stay grounded in our work. And we want to begin today with the words of Reverend Angel Kyoto Williams, the founder of the Center for Transformative Change in Berkeley, California, and the author of Radical Dharma and other works. Love and justice are not two. Without inner change, there is no outer change. Without collective change, no change matters. We begin here because the work of anti-racism is work of love and justice, of deepening presence and awareness and turning that into action. It is work that sees a different and more expansive possibility and steps toward it with the aim of bringing it fully to life. It is also inner change work as much as it is collective change work. It's a way of being in the world in which you're paying close attention to both the inner space, the lens through which you see and the role you play, and asking curious and critical questions about the beliefs and assumptions and experiences shaping that lens, and the behaviors and practices you choose to bring forward. And the outer space, the stories and the systems around you, and the role of power in shaping and telling those stories and designing and perpetuating the systems, and how those two spaces are in constant interaction. We're going to share just a little bit about what pulls us to this work and how we engage with it. I'd like to hand off to Kim first to introduce herself.
Thanks, Natalie. And it's such a pleasure to be with each of you via this platform. I am a mother, a daughter, an advocate for social justice, and an independent consultant and leadership coach based here in the Washington, D.C. area. My interest in anti-racism work stems from my upbringing in Brooklyn, New York in the 1970s, a period of Afros and dashikis and Black is beautiful as sources of pride and power within my community. I'm drawn to this work because I see clear connections between those early childhood experiences and my preparedness and stamina to engage in work that pushes back against injustice and marginalization. Gloria?
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. As an applied sociologist, my training is in analyzing inequities, and my interest is in taking action and supporting others as they work towards eliminating inequities. I'm the daughter of Mexican immigrants, and I grew up in racially segregated neighborhoods and public schools in Southern California. I identify as Latinx, and my background and experiences and my work as an independent consultant and leadership coach drive me to help individuals and organizations move meaningfully towards equity and inclusion. Natalie.
Thank you. I'm also a leadership coach and consultant. I'm a mother, wife, friend, and my purpose is to embolden leaders and their organizations to change the world for good. I'm the daughter of Polish immigrants who didn't speak the language when I was young and spent my early years made to feel different, sparking curiosity early on for me about what it means to belong. Fast forward to today, when I see the power and privilege I have and have always had as a white woman, when I see so much inequity and so many who are made to feel as though they don't belong, and that status quo is not acceptable to me. I'm drawn to this work because I choose not to be complicit in perpetuating it. I choose working toward equity and possibility. Now consider for a moment, who are you? Now that we've shared a little bit about what pulls us into this work, we want to talk about our purpose today. What does our time together look like? We're going to explore what makes this work critically important now, what it means to be anti-racist, and how you can show up as an anti-racist leader. As part of that, we'll be going through some common terms. We'll be talking about the structural nature of racism and why it's important to understand what that means. We hope you notice more about what shapes your lens and the environment that you're in. And we hope you walk away with some tangible ideas for ways to apply anti-racist principles in your leadership. We're excited to dive in, and we want to start with a question to give us a sense of where you're coming from. Sarah, we'd like to open the first poll. And the first question is, what is your experience with anti-racism work?
Great, so I've just launched a poll out to you all. If you can just take a couple seconds to reply. You can say you're not familiar and this is the first time you're hearing the term anti-racism. Maybe you're somewhat familiar, you've heard about it and you're curious to know more. Maybe you're a bit familiar, you've begun learning and engaging in anti-racism work yourself. Or maybe you're very familiar and you're actively engaged in anti-racism work now. So pick your option. I'll leave the poll open for just a couple more seconds and then we'll kind of get a sense of where our audience is. All right, great. So it looks like in terms of percentages, so 8% of the audience said that they are not familiar. This is the first time you're hearing the term anti-racism. 25% said that they're somewhat familiar. They've heard about it before and they're curious to know more. 44% said that they are familiar. They've begun learning and engaging in anti-racism work. And 22% said that they're very familiar, so actively engaged in anti-racism work now. Thank you all so much for your responses.
Yes, thank you, Sarah. And it's great to see that for many of you, this is not the first time you're entering into this type of conversation. And for those of you for whom it is the first time, welcome. And we view this opportunity as a real invitation. And Sarah, I am not able to advance
since we started the poll.
Just click back on your slides physically. Yeah, perfect.
All right, here we go. Great. So now that we have a sense of where you're coming from, we want to pivot into the broader why for this work. What makes it important now? In some ways, what makes it important now is what has always made it important. Fundamental questions of how we want to be with one another in community. What do you aspire to, and what dreams do you hold? If you knew your neighbor was terrified to walk down the street, what would you do? What would you say to parents whose kids don't feel safe? What if you're sitting next to someone on a plane you don't know, and they explain reality in ways that are very different from yours? How do you respond? We see people stuck in an increasingly polarized public discourse, clinging to positions, some of which we've included here as examples, as though there's only one way we can be together, as though we're in a binary conversation where we have to choose one or the other, us versus them, where our deeply felt rightness about our position prevents engaging in real conversation. And we see people very much wanting not to be stuck, wanting a way through, because we have work to do, and it takes all of us to define our democracy. Anti-racism work acknowledges this complex tension, and it offers a new lens through which to understand where we are and how we can move forward. This work has also come to the surface in a series of events over the last few years. The Black Lives Matter activist movement that serves to affirm all Black lives and to protest violence and systemic racism toward Black people. The Me Too movement, giving voice to countless women who felt silenced by sexual assault and predominantly male power structures. Colin Kaepernick using his prominence as an athlete to protest police brutality and racism at great personal cost. Layla F. Saad's Me and White Supremacy workbook, going from an Instagram challenge to confront racist beliefs and behaviors to a viral phenomenon for thousands of people wanting to engage more deeply in this work. In all of these events, we also see the legacy of individuals and systems interacting with one another and the role of power in that interaction. Power dynamics are at the heart of this work. And I'm going to hand off to Gloria to take us deeper into the ways racism manifests at every level.
Great. Thank you, Natalie. So next, as a personal reflection exercise, we have a question meant to get you thinking about how you're thinking. So consider this. If a child asked you, what is racism? What might you respond? There's no right or wrong answer here. This is really an opportunity to personally reflect on this question. If you could, please jot down for yourself what comes to mind. And please also share your thoughts with us by typing them in the chat box. We'll give you about 30 seconds to do that, to think about that, and we'd love to hear what ideas you come up with. So when we ask this question, we often see a mix of responses that range from individual acts of racism to examples of embedded systemic issues. Next, we're going to spend just a little bit of time defining racism, also structural racism, and then anti-racism. So what do we mean when we say race? So race is socially constructed, meaning race is a creation of categories used to distinguish people into groups. Classifications of race are based on arbitrary physical attributes such as skin color, hair color, texture, or other physical features. Though these physical features may appear to be very dramatic that distinguish us from one another, we as a species have been estimated to share 99.9% of our DNA with each other. So while the concept of race has no basis in biological reality, the concept of race exerts a powerful influence in our society. So what do we mean when we say racism? Racism rests on a classification created by white people in positions of political and economic power that creates a hierarchy of value according primarily to skin color. The Alberta Civil Liberties Research Center describes racism as saying that in Western or European history, white people were and are still located at the top of this hierarchy, occupying the position of the ideal or the norm, with others lower on the list presented as deviations from or less than this ideal or norm. This concept can be understood in terms of power and who has access to it and what structures enable and protect power or hinder access to power. So what do we mean by structural racism? Structural racism is the normalization and legitimization of an array of historical, cultural, institutional, interpersonal, and individual factors that routinely advantage whites while producing cumulative and chronically adverse outcomes for people of color. Here in this graphic, we talk about first individual racism as a manifestation of racism with a single person. So examples include personal prejudice, xenophobia, which is fear and hatred of anything that is strange or foreign, and other beliefs about race influenced by the dominant culture. Individual racism can be deliberate or implicit. In other words, the individual may act to perpetuate or support racism without knowing that he or she is doing it. Examples are telling a racist joke, using a racial epithet, or believing in the inherent superiority of whites over others. Another example would be avoiding people of color whom you do not know personally, but not avoiding whites whom you don't know personally. This might be an example of a white person crossing the street to avoid a group of Latino young people. Example would be locking car doors when a black person is walking by or they're in a black neighborhood. Or even not hiring a person of color because just something just doesn't feel right. A final example would be just accepting things as they are. In other words, being okay with existing inequities. All right, so what do we mean by interpersonal racism? Interpersonal racism occurs between individuals, such as the way we treat others and build relationships, the language we use, and the behaviors we engage in. So examples are public expressions of racial prejudice, hate, bias, and bigotry between individuals. Institutional racism refers specifically to the ways in which institutional policies and practices create different outcomes for different racial groups. The institutional policies may never mention any racial group, but their effect is to create advantages for whites and disadvantages for people from groups classified as people of color. Examples are school discipline, where black students get suspended for being insubordinate much more frequently than white students. Another example is the disparate impact of voter identification requirements that create unequal barriers for the participation of all groups. Finally, another example would be sanitation and land use policies, which mean that you see more trash transfer stations and other environmental hazards in communities of color. So when you look again at this graphic, we hope that you can appreciate what makes this work complex and how many entry points there are. And we'll get into some of those a little later. And now that you've heard us describe structural racism, and as you consider the many dimensions of media, literature, art, public policy, what are some ways you see our culture privileging whiteness while disadvantaging color? Additionally, this structural racism contributes to shaping invisible norms, which impact everyday experiences negatively for some and positively for others. For example, predominantly white institutions often privilege white cultural norms, or rather invisible norms pertaining to communication style, professionalism, social interaction, and appropriateness. These can help to perpetuate access to resources for the dominant group and make it harder for other groups to gain access and progress. For those who are not white, people of color, the impact of these invisible norms might be feeling unwelcome or isolated or receiving differential treatment. It could also manifest by way of microaggressions, which are intentional and unintentional verbal or behavior communications of racial slights and insults. Now let's define the term anti-racism and what it means to be an anti-racist. For the work that we do together, Kim, Natalie, and I developed our definition, pulling from and drawing from various anti-racism definitions. For us, anti-racism is both about awareness and action. We view anti-racism as actively working towards resisting, dismantling, while simultaneously participating in the design and creation of a new experience of shared power that includes standing for equity, for dignity, rights, and community. When we say awareness, we're talking about deepening your learning and understanding of the lived experiences of people of color and Indigenous people, how racism has been foundational throughout history and has manifested both individually and through formal and informal institutional policies and practices. We're also talking about how white people participate in racism, often unknowingly. We see that awareness turning into action in two primary ways: the action of interrupting and dismantling the elements of the status quo that are sustaining racism, and the action of participating in creating new practices and systems that create greater equity. When thinking about this work, some people may wonder about the term diversity and may say they prefer the term diversity to anti-racism. So why aren't we talking about diversity today? We know that diverse teams are better at solving problems, at coming up with creative and innovative solutions. We know that plugging people in from diverse backgrounds into our current system does not address the power imbalances that exist. Diversity assumes that success is possible within the status quo for people of color and Indigenous people. Discourses about diversity often work in favor of maintaining systemic racism because they fail to consider, analyze, and oppose imbalances of power among diverse individuals and groups. We focus on anti-racism because it challenges the status quo in favor of a more equitable and just reality. And some people may also wonder about race as a focus and whether anti-racism excludes consideration of other forms of oppression at work in society, like discrimination based on gender, sexuality, ability, and class, for example. And we love the view of the Alberta Civil Liberties Center of Anti-Racism, that it is inclusive on the analysis of the intersectionality of various forms of power and oppression at work in our society and lives. Our primary focus for social change is racism, which is complicated and often reinforced by other forms of oppression. Because we live in a society that is so resistant to and uncomfortable with discussions of race and racism, we feel it's imperative to maintain this primary focus. In summary, anti-racism is a practice, it's an active process, and it is a way of seeing and being in the world in order to transform it. Now I'll hand it over to Kim, who'll discuss ways to begin applying anti-racism principles.
Great, thank you. So far we've talked about the cumulative adverse outcomes structural racism can have for people of color and about the systems that perpetuate those outcomes. We want to now shift our discussion to practical ways to engage in the work of resistance and dismantling systemic oppression. We'll talk about how you can begin applying anti-racism principles in the places where you live, work, and play. First, we'll explore those foundational stories and systems that are all around us, deepening our understanding of history and considering who crafted the narratives and understand the historical behavior and outcomes with a new lens. In that discussion, we invite you to pay attention to how language and messages, both past and present, are used to dehumanize people of color. We will discuss how you can enhance your capacity to see the role you may play as an individual leader within these stories and systems, and finally identify authentic action you can take. Let's start with some of the stories that may have shaped us. We'll show you a brief historical timeline as one way to examine those stories with a more critical frame. In this timeline, which starts in 1492, For many U.S. history courses taught today, the common poem in 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. And today we're able to name that period of colonialization of the Americas as a period of genocide. Colonialism occurs when foreign power invades a territory and establishes enduring systems of exploitation and domination over its indigenous populations. It destroys indigenous ways of life and obliterates indigenous economies. Colonizers justify their oppression through belief systems that humiliate indigenous peoples. Our question is, what would be different if we started the timeline before the European invasion, as the population of American Indians goes from 20 million to 350,000 by 1860? The second point in our timeline, we have included the famous words from the Declaration of Independence, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And it leads us to the question, a declaration for whom? When we consider the context in which our U.S. Constitution was established, how resources were divided, and whose voice would be part of the decision makers, does the three-fifths compromise of 1787 come to mind? At the U.S. Constitutional Convention, it was determined how slaves would be counted, and when determining the state's total population for legislative representation and taxing purposes, the compromise was to count 3 out of every 5 slaves as a person for this purpose, giving Southern states disproportionately greater power, while the slaves themselves could not vote. The Naturalization Act of 1790 was a law that limited naturalization to immigrants who were free white persons of good character. It thus excluded American Indians, indentured servants, slaves, free blacks, and later Asians. During this period, the growth of U.S. economy and the institutionalization of black slavery between 1660 and 1860 are inextricably linked. The annexation of Texas, Mexico, and Native American tribes led to widespread poverty, cultural devastation, and the loss of rights and citizenship. We mentioned earlier that race is a social construct with powerful influence. How did it come to be? The modern concept of race emerged amid revolutionary transformations, the rise of capitalism, nationalism, science, and colonialism as a new way of viewing and ordering the world in order to maintain dominance of a few. The third point on our timeline, quote, all persons held as slaves shall be thenceforward and forever free. From the Emancipation Proclamation, ending chattel slavery, and the enslavement of 3.1 million Africans in the U.S. This has to be a great historical timeline, time point, doesn't it? Yes, of course, and over-reliance on just that moment in history could cause us to miss the new systems that were emerging to exert dominance and sanction oppression. For example, lynching peaked from 1890 to 1920. In 1896, Plessy v. Ferguson, the landmark Supreme Court decision, upheld the constitutionality of racial segregation laws for public facilities. As long as segregated facilities were equal in quality, a doctrine that came to be known as separate but equal was the foundation of Jim Crow laws, which lasted well into the 1960s. Voting rights began to challenge through poll tax, literacy tests, and other forms of voter intimidation. The fourth point on our timeline is the iconic quote, I Have a Dream, spoken by Dr. Martin Luther King during the March on Washington in 1963. And yet, in many ways, I Have a Dream has been reduced to an aspirational speech about unity and equality between Blacks and whites. What is perhaps missed is a salient call to action about inequalities across a range of social issues and about the US government taking action. While the story, the narrative of the speech is synonymous with iconic representation of the period, it might serve to retain a structure of racism. Also, what were the other realities of the time? Leaders were killed and jailed, treaties with indigenous nations broken, and gaps between speech and systemic change. An unfortunate outgrowth of this period is that racism came to be identified with overt bigotry. What Dr. King was talking about was the system and how the system perpetuated inequality, not the racist behavior of a group of individuals. Removal of overt segregation laws led to subversive segregation, for example, in the rise of public housing projects. The final bullet on our timeline starts just on the heels of the civil rights movement with the war on poverty and war on crime under President Johnson, and the weaponized language that becomes part of our common lexicon. We then come to see the war on drugs in the 1970s, the war on terror in the 2000s, which are commonly described as a way to take positive aggressive action. The language suggests that taking a violent approach will have a positive outcome. The reality is, the language of war is used in a very specific way. Who are the poor, the criminal, the terrorist? The language becomes synonymous with Black and Brown people. If some people are a threat, what story does it allow us to tell ourselves? As you're thinking about how the language of war makes its way into the common vernacular, like you may have heard the phrase war on women as a way of calling out patriarchy, we wonder what purpose does it serve? Is it useful to embrace that weaponized language? Take a look again across the top of our timeline. Notice the story and use of language and what the message is and who it's for. What purposes do stories and narratives serve? If you look at the overall arc of history, the stories that are above the timeline are often presented as lovely, aspirational, we're taking this on kind of stories. And when we start to ask, what's the reality for our country and populations? What's the experience? Who does it benefit to tell the story in this way? As long as these stories remain unexamined and unquestioned, they make it possible to sanction behaviors that retain dominance, supremacy, hierarchy, and power. And yes, we are still swimming in racist narratives. If we look at the recent local and national headlines that continue to shape our narrative, we pulled a few that are familiar to many of us who are based in the Washington, D.C. region. The first blackface photo posted by Whitman students prompt hate-based investigation. This is a story that focuses on Walt Whitman High School, a public, prominent public high school here in the region where less than 10% of the student body is African-American. Notice that in the headline, no white students mentioned are named or named. Unlike criminals whose race and ethnicity is immediately highlighted. The second headline, also very local, a prominent bookstore in our area, mentions white nationalists. White nationalists interrupt author at politics and prose. Why not white supremacists? Interrupt author, that's one way of saying it, versus chanting, screaming, this land is my land, and occupying all the public space. Also, no mention that the author is white. And finally, taken from the national headlines, recent reference to the college bribery scandal, which exposed criminal conspiracy to influence undergraduate admissions at several U.S. universities. Lessons from a scandal: colleges quietly tighten the athletic recruiting process. So why not fraud? Nothing about the people involved. And one might assume just from the headline that the colleges were the primary culprit. So this was a lot, we know. Dense content, heavy, and somewhat fraught with emotion. So we want to give you a minute to reflect. So if you have a sheet of paper, notebook handy, what three points are you taking away from our conversation about narratives? It's an invitation to pay attention and notice the stories around us. Natalie?
Okay, thank you. So now that we've offered some foundational groundwork, we're going to talk about a number of different ways that you can begin applying anti-racism principles in your leadership. These slides serve as a beginning, and they offer key questions to ask yourself, along with potential entry points to the work. As we go through, consider what stands out to you. What sparks something for you? What do you feel pulled toward that could change how you show up? While we're going through these slides, we invite you to envision and jot down one thing you'll take on. As you might remember from the definition we shared of what makes someone an anti-racist, the first sort of big bucket of work is about building awareness. And this is critical for both deepening your learning and understanding and figuring out what authentic action could look like for you. In the beginning, it's important to consider what makes this work matter to you. For many of our clients, they reflect on this question in the context of values and strengths. So as you consider your values, what comes up? What's important? Are you able to live your values fully? How does this work align with your values and bring them to life? For example, if you value collaboration, how are you making sure all voices on your team are heard? If you value community, you may be drawn to engaging in this work with local community groups, schools, neighbors. Similarly, what would you say your strengths are? How might you play to your strengths in how you engage with this work? Some people think immediately of activists when they imagine this work, and that may resonate. Things like creating coalitions to call politicians, set up marches. Others may feel their strength is in listening and creating space for others to be heard. And they may be drawn to focus time on seeing and hearing the people on their teams and in their immediate circles. There are many ways in. Other questions that you might consider: what do you notice that you're wrestling with? Even if you've been listening to this webinar, what's come up for you? What legacy might you want to leave behind? While this reflection work takes time, it also enables you to engage with this work authentically for the long term. Now, we showed you a brief timeline earlier as a way to illustrate one way history may have been told and to offer an alternative lens based on lived experience. What did that open up for you? Where do you want to go deeper to understand the lived experience of people of color and Indigenous people? Understanding history is critical to understanding the power dynamics that persist and to shed light on what needs to be different. And when we say seek out different perspectives, consider who authored the history you've read and what voices are missing and necessary to get a fuller perspective. We also invite you to think about how you engage with people of color and Indigenous people in your learning. Are you asking questions that place additional burden on them to teach you? For example, asking a Black colleague to speak for the experience of all Black employees at an organization is a form of microaggression, placing undue burden on that individual to do the impossible and negating the individuality of each Black employee there. Alternatively,
Are you paying attention and listening actively for openings where you can step in with genuine curiosity and a desire to understand? If someone is courageous enough to share that they experienced treatment that was racist in the workplace, that's an entry point. Where do you go? If that happens, do you look for ways to explain it away and keep your story about the organization intact? Or do you want to understand what really happened? And if they share, what do you do? Another way into building understanding and perspective is to consider an alternative narrative. Walk back through your life up until now and tell yourself the story again as a member of a different racial group. What changes? I'm going to hand over to Gloria to offer some additional ways of building awareness.
Great. So while we're going through these next few slides, we want to ask you to maybe jot down one or two things that you want to take on. So a reminder to do that. So now if we think about how we might be complicit in racism, it begins with not even thinking about what you know to be true. One way to build awareness about how you participate, perhaps unknowingly, in racism includes examining and re-examining our beliefs and assumptions. A starting point for building this awareness is to consider the images and narratives about different racial groups that you were exposed to and grew up with. What were those? And what are those images and narratives about different racial groups now? Another entry point is to reflect on the visual representations you associate with what for example, a good neighborhood or a good school or a good person looks like. Without realizing it, are the people in these pictures of a particular race? And finally, another entry point to build greater awareness is examining everyday practices and norms that you uphold. For example, what are your ideas and expectations of what credibility looks like and sounds like in a professional setting? What qualities do you associate with authority and leadership? If there's an instance when you're heading to a meeting with a CEO, and let's say you walk into the office and two people are standing up, say a white woman and a Latino man, close your eyes and think a CEO right now. What is your initial assumption about who the CEO is in that situation? So this example is not meant to be an indictment. It's meant to show the power of bias and socialization has on our everyday experiences, the degree to which our beliefs and assumptions are rooted in race-based ideology and our stereotypes. Additionally, building awareness about the types of systemic racism that exist around you can do by noticing a few things. First would be, what racist attitudes and behaviors do you see many people adopting knowingly or unknowingly? You can also consider a staff meeting. In that staff meeting, who has the power? Who's speaking? Who is silenced? But also who isn't in the room? What policies and practices hinder equity intentionally or unintentionally? And also think about when someone or you might say, oh, this is how we get things done around here. Consider whether that statement is largely based on who you know. So who's advantaged, who's disadvantaged? For example, what are some common organizational practices for recruiting potential hires? Does the organization tend to recruit and hire from a limited pool of certain schools or the same professional networks? So now I'm gonna hand over to Kim, who'll talk about taking action to interrupt and dismantle the behaviors, practices, and structures that sustain racism over time.
So great, thanks, Gloria. We're going to first talk about what it might look like to interrupt and dismantle racist behaviors. Again, last reminder, if you envision or one thing that you might want to take on as a result of this conversation, we ask you to jot it down. So let's look at what it takes to dismantle racist behaviors. Imagine you're in a team meeting and you notice the following. There's one young woman of color on an all-white male team. She offers an idea. No one responds. Moments later, a young white man restates the idea almost verbatim. Several people nod in support and acknowledge the good idea. You see the young woman who spoke earlier look down and remain quiet. You sense something is wrong. This moment is an entry point for you. In this scenario, consider the opportunity for you as the leader to listen deeply and pay attention to what's being said and perhaps unsaid. In this scenario, a lot is happening beneath spoken words. To discern what you might do, consider your values. Remember, we talked about values as a first step in building awareness. Values are motivations behind our behaviors and actions. To interrupt racist behaviors, start with the question, what do I stand for? What do I believe in and why? Use that value to inform your actions and practices. In this scenario, we described, it is in line with your values. Is it in line with your values that the young woman is silenced? If that goes against your values, how could you see and hear her differently? What could you do to create space for her and bring her voice back into the conversation? One common approach is calling in and calling out. Calling in means demonstrating compassion in moments people make harmful mistakes and inviting them to learn and change behavior. Calling out means overtly naming the offense as a way to assert a standard for behavior. So what might it look like to call in or call out in this scenario? To call in, you could say, I'm noticing that on this team, we all play a role and contribute, and we don't all create space for one another. You point out to the young man that he essentially repeated what she was saying and invite her to share more about her idea. Invite them to co-create and build the idea out together. To call out, you could say, here we have a young woman of color being silenced on an all-white male team. What are we saying about our commitment to inclusion if this is the way we behave? Now we're shifting to what it might look like to interrupt and dismantle racist practices and structures. So before we talked about behaviors, now we're shifting to practices and structures. Recognizing that the failure to address core problems or incidents undermine trust and safety, it's important for our leaders courageously to lean into moments of discomfort and uncertainty. So imagine you want to recruit a talented pool of analysts from diverse backgrounds. And you notice when you look at the colleges and universities they've come from over the last 5 years, you're recruiting from a limited pool. You're troubled by this and don't know where to begin. You can almost always begin with gathering some data. So you may go to HR and ask how the organization started from recruiting this pool. So let's say they're not sure. In anecdotal conversations, you learn that many of the current analysts are from certain geographic regions and part of established networks that current leaders are also part of. You're not even surprised given how much we operate in social networks, and you wonder how you could change this. You look for people who care about making this kind of change and engage them in conversations. You go to trusted colleagues of color to test your assumptions and ask them to react. You create coalitions that find ways to build relationships with new schools and new pools of talent. So finally, what role do you want to play in shaping the future? So there are opportunities at work, certainly, and there may be opportunities elsewhere. So we don't want you to feel limited just by discussions about the workplace. So let's say you want to create practices and systems that create greater equity in the world. Shaping the future is getting more people to look at this work differently. Your participation in this work as a leader is not a form of charity. In the conversations you're part of, how can you encourage people to shift their thinking from magnanimous savior mentality and charity to be genuinely present with one another as equals? Is there a conversation you want to start within a parent community or with your children or neighborhood youth? Is there a social justice or racial justice issue in your community that you'd like to help solve? Are there organizations within your community you could volunteer with or get involved with? This is an encouragement that the change starts with you. It may sound trite, it might sound simple, but it starts with you and your intention. So Natalie's gonna sort of summarize and then ask you a final question.
Thank you, Kim. So looking back at where we've been, we've spent some time looking at really what it means to be an anti-racist, what it means to practice anti-racism, and the core elements of that work in building awareness at different levels, in taking action to interrupt and dismantle racist behaviors and practices and structures over time, and in participating in designing new practices and systems that create greater equity. And we asked you before, you know, as we were going, jot down the things that come up for you. Take note of what sparks something and what you feel pulled toward. We like to close our learning sessions with action. So our last polling question is about commitments. We invite you now to share with us in the question field or in the chat box, what one thing will you commit to doing? And we'll give you a moment to share. Okay, thank you. We are excited to see all of the different things that you'll be stepping into. We want to close today with the wisdom of Audre Lorde. Each of us is called upon to take a stand. So in these days ahead, as we examine ourselves and each other, our works, our fears, our differences, our sisterhood and survivals, I urge you to tackle what is most difficult for us all. Self-scrutiny of our complacencies, the idea that since each of us believes she is on the side of right, she need not examine her position. We urge you, as she did, to keep noticing, to keep learning, and to keep turning that awareness into action, and to remember that you have extraordinary potential and power within you to create a more just and equitable world. We thank you for spending this time with us. We've included our email. We look forward to hearing from you if you'd like to learn more about our work. And we have just a few minutes remaining. We'd love to open it up for some questions.
Thanks so much to all three of you. This was such a powerful and amazing presentation. I'll be sending out contact information for our presenters as well. So I really encourage you to follow up with further questions or comments or areas of discussion. Please do feel free to send in your questions, and thanks so much for all of your comments and responses so far during the webinar. It's great to see.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and just take a few questions. The first one here is, question is, I wonder if you have any advice for me, as my organization has made it clear that tackling issues in the anti-racism realm is not a true priority. Okay, so this question might resonate with many of you. I guess the one thing we could start with is just thinking about the ways you notice it's not a priority. You know, what are the possible entry points, for example, that you can think about how to tackle this anti-racism? It could be maybe an indirect way, right? There might be some allies, identifying some individual or group that is finding anti-racism very important to them. So I would say thinking about kind of reevaluate the situation with a new lens, kind of given what you've what we've talked about today, and thinking about what are other entry points. There are always possibilities, you know, being creative about that and not giving up.
So we've gotten another question in that is, how do you reduce the risk to your work by calling out racism? And the way that we're interpreting that question is, you know, there, it feels like there's risk in using your voice and bringing it up that you're not sure how your team or maybe your organization will respond. And it's a real question, right? There are, we understand the sentiment, right? And we think about a couple of different things. So one thing that comes up for me right away is, what is the risk of staying silent? And really reflecting on that question, what is it that's causing discomfort to come up? Is it that you genuinely worry for yourself in terms of opportunity? Are you worried for safety? There's a spectrum of responses here that, you know, are important to consider. And, you know, thinking about what we've shared and what we've discussed, thinking about your values, thinking about the difference that you can make for one person if, for example, you're witness to an interaction of racist behavior and what you can do to support another. You have to come to that answer yourself in how you want to show up and give voice and stand up for what you believe in.
I think there might be one other question that seemed on that spectrum. Anti-racism feels like a big term full of a lot of emotion. Is there anything wrong with calling it something else? So that's a very frequent question, right? How can we kind of skirt around use of language that may seem confrontational? And I think our answer to that is really that there are realities that only maybe you know in the space in which you work and live. You know what, which things will maybe put up walls immediately and perhaps sort of ways to maybe finesse a situation. So I would say our answer is both, yes, there are real realities and there are possibilities. In our work, we have seen organizations that have missions that really support equity and social justice. And for those organizations that want to make big, bold, courageous moves, we definitely encourage them to push a little bit more and incorporate really powerful language, including anti-racism. So yes, there are realities and there are possibilities. Is that it, Sarah? Thank you.
I think that's it. And we want to be mindful of time too. And again, thank you so much for joining us. I know there, you know, if there are any things that you would continue to like to ask or that we didn't get to answer, we look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you all so much for this presentation today. This was wonderful and really, really helpful. And those of you, again, I'll encourage you, please follow up with Natalie, Kim, and Gloria after today's presentation. Thanks so much for taking the time out of your day to be here with us on this important topic. And be on the lookout for the recording of this webinar to be posted on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel. Thank you all so much. I'll wish you Hoya Saxa from the hilltop and have a great rest of your day.